Welcome to the American Dream. This is Dr. Stanley L. We'll hear from a guest in just a moment.
This is WGLS Rowan Radio.
And welcome again to the American Dream. And your host, Stanley L. Today we have in the house, well, actually, it's in the house of Woodbury Junior Senior High School, to be exact. So it's a fun show. I mean, this is the second time we're recording from Woodbury High School. And we have the privilege of doing it a second time with a Woodbury High alumni. Am I correct?
That is correct. Jared, class of 2012.
Hey, Jared Hunter.
Yes, thank you so much.
2012. Well, man, that's a few years ago.
A few years. I'm not the spring chicken I once was.
We don't go there, man. Yeah. You talk about spring chicken. Yeah. What am I?
And we're already on to our next segment.
I must be at you, right? Yeah. Am I the side of the barn? Or what? Carlton's like, yeah, Carlton's in the house.
We have fun.
He's still spring chicken, though. Yeah. He's a young guy, man. Okay. Like, he still got all his hair. But you still have your hair, too.
I still have my hair, luckily. Yeah,
no gray. I don't see any gray up there yet.
I have one.
You have one?
One, I checked, but I can't lose it just yet. It keeps me humble.
Keeps you humble. I'm a very humble guy.
That's right.
Well, anyway, Jared, this is the American Dream. I'm glad you... This is the first time on the show, right?
It is. Thank you.
Being on the show for the first time, I got to tell you this. The American Dream is, I think, a very unique show in the sense that we allow people to come on to the show. We have a patriotic kind of flair to it, and largely spiritual. I mean, we don't mind people talking about God as much as they need to. But I feel it's a special show because of the positivity that comes to each guest. And intentionally stay away from very, very popular people because it kind of waters things down. We want the real deal with people.
Right.
So we're really kind of searching to inspire our audience through our guest stories.
I'll take that as a compliment.
Oh, you know it, man. Absolutely. You know it's a compliment. Yeah. I mean, I have a chance to work with you. I know what you think. Yeah. I know how you feel about things. Mm-hmm. You're, in my mind, a pioneer.
Oh, thank
you. I mean, you might learn that later, but, in my mind, you're a pioneer.
Right. I appreciate it.
But why don't you start by giving the audience a little profile?
Sure. Anyway. So I am not original to Woodbury. I actually grew up in Williamstown, which is farther south in Gloucester County, but I'm a South Jersey boy, born and raised. And my family and I actually moved to Woodbury in 2010, graduated from Woodbury High in 2012, and decided to run across the bridge for undergrad and went to University of the Sciences. I started off as a pharmacology major, thinking I was going to get into science and math, and then realized that wasn't my strong suit. So. Mm-hmm. Made what was at the time a pretty difficult decision to change my major, but I now have a bachelor's of humanities in science, and I think it was one of the best decisions I made because it put me on the track to where I am. And I got really interested in policy and politics and government, and so I just finished my first master's in public administration at Rutgers Camden, and I'm on track at the end of this semester in December to receive my second master's of science in public affairs and PhD in public affairs after that. So it's a lot of education I shotgun through, but hopefully, there's some payoff in the end.
And the ultimate goal being?
Well, I work for local government now here in Woodbury, right across the street at City Hall, actually. And I've always been interested in how local government can be the axis around which community gathers. And so that has always been one of the goals of my career and my professional life is to be able to, as either an administrator or head of a department, I would love to work for state government one day and really affect change to that level to let folks know that resources are available, their voices are useful, and they can build up what's already been laid down and, to be able to contribute more positively to their communities.
Nice, nice. Yeah. I'm listening to you, and what's going through my mind is all the work and study I've done in regard to America's founding, because I'm a history kind of guy, but in particular, the Constitution and, because, we the people was really what they meant. Right. We the people at the lowest possible level.
That's right.
And the power be given there, it kind of filters up, to the state and federal levels as opposed to the opposite way around. And it's kind of nice listening to you because we need to get back to where we were.
I think so. I think a little bit. It has become a very, bureaucracy is one of those things that you can't necessarily get around. And I actually attribute one of my aspirees is President Wilson. and who was actually a governor of New Jersey. And, you know, he actually helped lay the cornerstone for Woodbury High School back in the 30s, I believe, when it was originally built. And, you know, the way that government, we understand modern government today, is because of him. And I think that he got parts of it right. You know, I think that there was that sense of being able to have folks walk through a process with a problem and come out with a solution. And I think I agree, you know, the way that our founding fathers set up the Constitution was the same way. We've deviated here and there. I think that a lot of people get caught up in the popularity of politics, and that gets weighed down in the way that we do the work. But I still like to believe that there's that nugget of the original thinking still in government today.
Oh, yeah. You know, I would say on that point that it's in the heart of the people naturally. You know, we all want to be independent and control our own lives by just instinct of being here.
Sure.
You know, we come together as a body of people. Obviously, we have the right, the privilege to elect somebody to represent us. I mean, it's only natural.
Right.
You know, so that part of, I don't think we've gotten away from that, but I do feel that we kind of get the, you know, the water's muddy with all the popular stuff and the, you know, the hoopla around politics. You know, that's really what kind of, to me, distorts where we go.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, a lot of education needs to be done around this thing called the social contract, right? You know, this idea that we give a certain amount of power and representation for a greater purpose to a smaller group of folks. A lot of people look at that as a strength. Some people look at that as a weakness. And the way that we've set our country up, we've kind of shifted and not understood that setup that we have kind of intrinsically in the way that we do government, right? You know, we elect folks to represent us to these larger extents to put public policies in place that will hopefully come back and have a benefit in our lives. The importance of that, I don't think people draw the dots, right? They don't connect one from the other. And I think that it's important, you know, why I think voter registration and the ability to engage civically is a huge starting point in folks being able to get back to drawing those dots and figuring out, if this is a guy that's going to say these things on my behalf, I want to make sure that the benefits come back correctly. And that's a really powerful relationship that folks have with government, whether they like it or not. And so I think that it's important to be educated and to understand that. And I think it'll really garner a lot more energy in folks being, you know, able to go out to the polls every November or June or whenever your primary or general elections are.
Good. Yeah. I mean, we could obviously go into politics, but I don't want to do that.
Yeah.
What would you say is your American dream?
My American dream, I think, is for underrepresented and marginalized communities to be able to have a part of the pie, right? To have a seat at the table in terms of what public policies impact and benefit their lives. You know, I think that the American dream, you know, this idea of the white picket fence and 2.5 children and the dog and the nice grass, it's a great idea. But I think that especially now as we have evolved and, you know, millennial and Generation Z people have come up into the fray, I think that the original traditional idea of the American dream is a little bit, you know, stale, right? I think that there's an opportunity for us to be able to really focus on how do we make sure that folks' voices and what they want their American dream to look like becomes a reality. That's mine. You know, I do have the house and I've got the couple of dogs and, you know, they drive me crazy and we cook dinner every Tuesday, you know, and all that kind of stuff. You can have all of that. It's a great thing to have. But I think that without folks being able to be engaged in their community and feel comfortable and confident in sharing their views, their beliefs, and their voice, especially with their local government, the folks, again, to the social contract, the folks that are supposed to represent their values, when we get to that point, I don't think it'll necessarily ever reach that kind of apex, but, you know, as long as we keep striving toward that idea, I would be able to sleep at night.
You know, it's interesting when you talk about the original American dream. I see it differently. I know the white picket fence story, but I don't feel that came from the original meaning of the Constitution and what they were trying to represent. To me, it's liberty. And I equate liberty as the freedom to express your talents and ability to their fullest extent. You know, to me, I have talents and abilities. I have my dreams. I want to be able to reach out and go and do those things. It may not include a white picket fence and all that kind of stuff. You know, and I know with the founders, that was important because they looked at the population as a resource, mm-hmm. a source for engineering and for new ideas, for pioneering the country. And they wanted people to be free to that because you got persecuted before that.
Sure.
For thinking outside the box.
Sure. And I think this is important because even now, in the way that I view community development and civic engagement work, you have to look at folks as a resource. Mm-hmm. You have to understand that everyone has some type of talent, they have an ability, they have a strength and a natural asset to the way that they can contribute to their community. And I do think that, again, local government needs to be able to reshift the way that they put policies into place through that lens. If we have this notion that the folks who live here and work here and play here have something to contribute, and we reach out to them first and tell us what it is that we should be kind of striving for, the direction that we should be moving towards, you will have a much more sustainable community, you'll have a much more engaged community, and you could get to that point where you reach back to that original founding document and say that I think we've kind of gotten this liberty thing down.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, yeah. Mm-hmm. Good, good, good. You know, it's interesting, too, because there's some research has been done, I think through the National Center of Constitutional Studies, where they had figured out that a local municipality, the people who have, can literally resolve any kind of poverty within that district within themselves without governmental support.
Sure, yeah. I think we talked about this during our last podcast episode, but, you know, I do believe that the people closest to the problem are closest to the solution,
mm-hmm.
absolutely.
Mm-hmm. You know, and you look at Woodbury, I mean, Woodbury is, like, you know, very nicely seated, you know, financially. When you look mm-hmm. at the range of, there's a lot that can happen here.
Absolutely.
I mean, you get some creative people, you know, backing up some brawn, some muscle, and some money.
Mm-hmm.
You can make some great things happen.
Absolutely. And I think it does. It takes a little bit of vision, mm-hmm. you know, and it takes some leadership to be able to put the, again, to connect those dots. But when you have them in place, I used to work in Camden, and I ran a national program called the National Consumer Scholars Program. And we would bring folks from all across the country to our national conferences, who were dealing with what we called complex health and social needs. You know, they were dealing with chronic debilitating physical diseases, but they also had the social aspects of their lives that were actually exacerbating their health.
Mm.
You know, they would be dealing with diabetes, but they couldn't get transportation to their dialysis. And so this would exacerbate, you know, their mm-hmm. kidney failure and their need for insulin. And the important thing that we found was that with these conferences and with this program was, when you put those folks who have gone through that process on the ground level in front of insurance payers and healthcare executives, and you step back, 9 times out of 10, they will be the ones who are asking the toughest questions. They will be the ones who will follow up every day until they get the answers that they need. And they will be the ones who solve the problems that they're bringing to these folks.
Mm.
It really is astounding the amount that you can get done when you have the right people and Absolutely. Give them access and step back. It's great.
Absolutely. You have to be able to step back.
That's
though.
Right.
Hands off.
That's right. It's tough. You know, you always want to have your hand in the pie.
Oh, yeah. You know, it's interesting, though, because listening to you, I know your educational background, and you seem very well equipped to handle what you want to do in terms of policies and all that. My question is for our audience is, how did you become this? I mean, come on. You came from the hood, bro.
I did. I grew up, we grew up really poor, actually. You know, it was 7 of us crammed in a 3-bedroom apartment for the first 10 years of my life. You know, I shared a twin-size bed with my brother, and we were the same age, essentially, you know. So imagine 2 of me in a twin size bed for 10 years. You mm-hmm. you start to get a little rowdy, and you know, electricity wasn't always where it needed to be. Water, hot water. But we grew up in a Baptist church,
mm.
And so I also am a man of faith.
Mm.
And it was very much tested in 2010 before we got to Woodbury. My family and I, we actually lost our home in March of 2010. And between March and July of 2010, we were actually essentially homeless. You know, we lived in a motel in Turnersville, and my father was working at an up-and-coming pizza shop, but was making no money. And I was forced to find a job at 15. And so across the street, I would sweep hair at a barbershop a couple hours a day after school. You know, you find this grit and you find this ability to lean on nothing, kind of paradoxically or ironically, when you know, you look at faith. Mm-hmm. And that was the driving force behind my ability to, you know, look at my situation, make the best of it, and just kind of hold on. You know, I, as a 15-year-old kid, had nothing to do with the state, the DCA, the housing authority that was in charge of making sure that we eventually found a place to live. So I did what I could, and mm-hmm. I leaned on the faith that I had and that, you know, I grew up with. We were going to church actually right here in Woodbury at the time, at Gethsemane Church of Woodbury on Stewart and Lafayette and, you know, South Woodbury. And those folks held us together. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't think that there's anything greater than a loving church family because it got us through. And the ability to lean on that faith, to lean on those folks and that love, and to just kind of hold on and do what you can has always been the driving force of what got me through. So even when I was at college, same type of thing. You know, I would constantly be texting and calling my pastor. I actually started a Bible study at college the first year I was there just to make sure that I held steadfast. Mm-hmm. And it's followed me. You know, you don't lose something like that. And it propels you when you use it right.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Obviously, I can see exactly where you're coming from with mm-hmm. that, and I can just say I can feel you, bro.
Yeah. Fist bump there.
Okay. Closing out this segment of the show, what do you feel would be your greatest victory?
I think the ability to be able to be looked at as a person who can direct. Mm-hmm. I was a resident advisor on campus at U Sciences, and my first year as a resident advisor, I had 350 residents coming to me with all of their problems, and I loved it because mm-hmm. I loved being a problem solver. But very quickly, you realize that 350 people coming to you with your problems every day is daunting and it's exhausting, and you get very used to and comfortable directing, you know, and letting people know, I don't know the answer, but I know someone who can kind of give you the answer. And I love to now be that person. You know, before when I was a little bit of a younger guy, I loved being that kind of, you know, force, and that vortex, that axis around which people centered. But I quickly realized that, you know, what was most important was that people got to the solutions that they needed, mm-hmm. whether or not I had a hand in it or whether or not I was the one that gave them the solution. The important thing was the outcome. And so I think that my greatest victory, whether it's spiritually, emotionally, you know, politically, legally, whatever the situation may be, sure, you can come to me with that problem, no doubt. But it might not end with me, right? Mm-hmm. But as long as we both understand that, I would be extremely happy for the rest of my days to know that that was my role in someone's life.
Well said. I appreciate you all the way. Yeah. We're going to close with that statement, and we'll be back after these messages.
Welcome back to The American Dream. I now present to you Beyond the Barriers with Stanley L.
Whether you're raising a family, advancing a career, building a business on a mission from God, victory lies beyond the barriers. It isn't often that an individual learns to speak from the heart. Fact is, speaking in general seems to be an impulse rather than a conscious deliberation of truth. This is what is meant when I say speaking from the heart. There's a connection when speaking from the heart that brings into being a delivery of speech, feeling, and experience that goes beyond normal comprehension. This at-one-ment or connection goes deep into the realms of higher consciousness. This expression in speech means a vibration that raises the consciousness of all listeners. This high rate of vibration transcends all opposition, including confusion. It strikes the core or heart of one's being, allowing crystal clear comprehension plus an inner relationship to form. This is the power of the spoken word, the very heart of the inner expression that comes from the sincere quest for immortal purity, eternal truth, and perfection. Speaking from the heart, one goes beyond the expressions of human ideas and desires, stress, and limitations. I am the strength that carries the power to move forward steadily through all experiences, whatever they may be, and to remain joyous and uplifted, filled with peace and harmony at all times, by the glorious presence which I am.
The American Dream, reality on Rowan Radio, 89.7 WGLS-FM, with host Stanley L.
I believe in the United States of America as a government of the people, by the people, for the people, whose just powers are derived from the consent of the governed, a democracy and a republic, a sovereign nation of many sovereign states, a perfect union, one and inseparable, established upon those principles of freedom, equality, justice, and humanity, for which American patriots sacrificed their lives and fortunes. I therefore believe it is my duty to my country to love it, to support its constitution, to obey its laws, to respect its flag, and to defend it against all enemies, everywhere, forever.
The 21st Principle of Liberty states, strong local self-government is the keystone to preserving human freedom.
And that concludes the American Dream. I'd like to thank you, our listeners, for sharing your time and attention. I'd like to thank Woodbury Junior and Senior High School for letting us use their production studio. Dr. Vincent Dow, he's not a doctor yet, but in my mind, he's a great guy, so we'll leave it at that. He's a pioneer buddy of mine, and I definitely thank him for being here. And you check out his show if you go on YouTube, checking us out. Of course, our wonderful guest, our magnificent guest, and hopefully a comrade of mine in the future, Gerard Hunter.
Thank you so much for having me.
Hey, you know, you're family, man.
Yeah, yeah. That's right. No, I do, and I appreciate it. I mean, we've talked about this before, but I really do look at you as one of my mentors. And
oh, gosh.
Yes, it's out there.
Can
now.
You be my mentor, yeah, too? No. I mean, does it work that way?
I hope not. I don't know. But no, I really appreciate the opportunity to speak with you.
Any final words for our audience out there?
Again, I really do think that, you know, if you feel like you have a voice and you would like to use it, I don't think that there should be any barrier for you to be able to. And any barrier that you come up against, just know that you have me in the fight with you against it, and we'll figure it out together, because the most important thing that we can do collectively is share our voices and create benefits for a greater folk.
Nice going. Okay, we're going to pass it over to Carlton.
And this has been the American Dream on Rowan Radio 89.7 WGLS FM. As always, have a great week, everyone.
American, the beautiful, we need you now.